because the second album was such a failure in all our eyes, I think it was the kind of impetus we needed just to think, well, we've got to really get it together here, you know, because it's either kind of make or break time.
As it always seems to for young British bands, America beckoned.
The first time we went to the States was 77, but we did our own gigs and we played like CBGBs and the Whiskey in Los Angeles, which were all right. They were just like little club gigs, and I think there was kind of enough interest on that level to make it worthwhile. People just coming and checking out what's, you know, all this hype about. But then our American agent booked us in with Blue Oyster Cult.
Which was the worst thing I could have possibly thought of or done had I known about music. But I didn't know they were heavy metal. I didn't know what they, I thought heavy metal was an heavy guitar. So I didn't know. I didn't have a clue.
Playing these huge stadiums or arenas, which are just totally, totally mismatched. And we'd go on and do probably like 30 minutes or less than that, 25 minutes, I suppose.
The sound, I used to keep running up and down from the front to back during the gig, bunging a few more dollars in the pocket to turn it up for us a bit. The sound guy was their guy, not ours. We didn't have a sound guy, couldn't afford one.
And they just hated us, the audience just hated us, you know. They were still only kids, probably our age, but they still had long hair and were smoking grass at the front, and, you know. So it was just kind of totally aliens what we were about or what we felt music was about.
They returned to the UK that spring amidst growing uncertainty. A projected new single, Billy Hunt, was shelved, although it was still on the cards when the band performed at the Paris Theatre in London for the BBC's Sight and Sound in Concert in June 1978.
We have a band who've been together just over a year and a half. They've been recording just over a year. They've had two albums out. Their latest single is a number entitled Billy Hunt. And here with that particular number, to start off their set, would you welcome, please, one of the finest bands around today, The Jam!
All was not well in The Jam camp. Bruce Foxton was writing frankly mediocre new songs to compensate for the dearth of new Weller material. Chris Parry and Polydor were not happy, and recordings for a new album were scrapped. So what was the reason for this sudden loss of interest from the usually driven Weller?
I fell in love, I think, probably for the first time. And as everyone knows, once you fall in love, everything else goes out the window for a period of time, you know.
It's difficult, because obviously you can't interfere with someone's personal life, but it was, unfortunately, it overspilled into the band life.
Well, he was infatuated. He sort of threw himself into a different world.
And I just wanted to stay at home and be with her. I wasn't really asked about singing or playing or writing songs for a period of time. And consequently, we started going down the pan.
I just walked into this meeting and it was like, you know, if you can imagine walking into Beirut, there was so much tension. And I'd only just started working with them and I thought, perhaps I should look for another gig. I mean, if it's going to be like this.
And I just said to Bruce, I said, Bruce, look, you know, The Jam is not going to run on your songs. End of story. Paul, you're just going to have to get your output sorted out. So they all went off in a bit of a half.
One of the best things Chris did was to come and say, look, this stuff is shit. And that just kind of just sort of, I thought, thank God someone's actually said it, you know. And I think, obviously, it upset a few people here and there, but I think it was the best thing he could have done.
I thought he was talking out of his arse myself, and I still do, personally. There's a period of time in everybody's career you have a good spell and a bad spell.
The original Kinks album was called Something Else by the Kinks, and I bought a copy in America, probably on the first or second American tour we did there. And I just thought it'd be right for us. I just thought it'd be a perfect thing for The Jam.
It didn't seem to bode well that The Jam's new single was a 60s cover version, but the results were impressive.
We weren't intending it to be a single at the time, but we started doing the live set and it just worked really well.
Perhaps due to his candid assessment of their new material, Chris Parry stopped co-producing with Vic Coppersmith Heaven, the team having worked together on the first two Jam LPs. Vic took over production for that crucial third album, and Weller went back to Woking and spent a few weeks writing terse, acutely observed new songs that were to prove to be the band's salvation.
The standard was just way higher. I mean, there's just some fantastic songs.
We'd like to do a new number. This is a song about all the hate in the world building up and exploding in Wardour Street. It's something called A-Bomb in Wardour Street. Well, this is our a Christmas out of town. Feeling pain, you got in the air. I should be now that dead new song. I don't know what I'm doing here. This is not my CFO. I'm out in what I see.
Like a lot of songs around that time, I was just writing them from his observation around me, the things that were going around me living in London. And I think London, and maybe England itself, you know, was a very violent place in the late 70s. At gigs, there was always fights, you know, you could almost sort of set your watch by it. Whether it was a club or a bigger place or whatever. Walking down the street at night after a club, you'd have to watch your ass because there's always that thing in the air that could go off, you know. Tube Station started off as just a lyric or a poem, if you like. I almost sort of saw it as a kind of like a little mini film or a little kind of TV drama.